This is Duke University.
I'll be introducing our first panelist today. William Andrews is E. Maynard Adams Professor of English and Comparative Literature at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. He's the author, editor, or co-editor of 45 books on a wide range of African-American literature and culture, chiefly before World War I. His titles include The Literary Career of Charles W. Chestnut and To Tell a Free Story, The First Century of Afro-American Autobiography, 1760 to 1865. He is co-editor of the Oxford Companion to African-American Literature and the Norton Anthology of African-American Literature, third edition. He is general editor of North American Slave Narratives, a database and electronic text library. The title of his paper today is Class Awareness in Antebellum Slave Narratives. Jessica Marie Johnson is an assistant professor in the Center for Africana Studies and Department of History at Johns Hopkins University. Johnson holds a PhD and MA in history from the University of Maryland, College Park, and a BA in African and African American Studies from Washington University in St. Louis, where she was also a Mellon Mays undergraduate fellow. Her research interests include women, gender, and sexuality in the African diaspora, histories of slavery and the slave trade, and digital history and new media. Her work has appeared in Slavery and Abolition, The Black Scholar, Debates in the Digital Humanities, and Meridians, Feminism, Race, and Transnationalism. As a digital humanist, Johnson is interested in ways digital and social media disseminate and create historical narratives, in particular, comparative histories of slavery and people of African descent, and the power of radical media to create social change. In 2008, she founded African Diaspora PhD, a blog highlighting scholars and scholarship in the field of Atlantic African diaspora history. The title of her paper today is La Traversée, Free Black Female Crossings in a World of Atlantic Slavery. Lamont Adu is the Andrew W. Mellon Assistant Professor of Romance Studies at Duke University. He received his PhD in Portuguese and Brazilian Studies from Brown University. Adu is a cultural historian and interdisciplinary scholar who specializes in early modern to 19th century Brazilian history and culture with a focus on slavery, race, sexuality, and law. He is the author or editor of three books, including Lima Bahetu, New Critical Perspectives, Emerging Dialogues on Machado de Assis, and Slavery Unseen, Sex, Power, and Brazil's Myth of Racial Democracy. The title of his paper today is Black Freedom and the Paradoxes of White Supremacy in Pre-Emancipation Brazil.
Good morning, everyone. So it's great to be here. Thank you, Jasmine, I think just did that, for having me and my panelists for joining me here. I'm really excited to talk about my work. And it's also nice to be here just commiserating this week. I mean, granted, we're talking about slavery, but that seems also very timely to think about and think about the way these histories are also really relevant and present today in the 21st century. So I will find us. Right. In early 1729, a Senegal mulatresse arrived in New Orleans, a muddy outpost near the mouth of the Mississippi River. Like so many Africans crossing the Atlantic during the first decades of the 18th century, she embarked from the Senegambia Comtois, or trading forts, of Saint Louis and Gorée, aboard a French slave ship, and in the company of hundreds of shackled men, women, and children. However, and unlike the majority of Africans making the same voyage from Saint Louis or Gorée to New Orleans, she did not arrive enslaved. Her name was Marie Baud, and she was a slave-owning free woman of African descent, traveling of her own volition. Her husband, Jean Pinet, a company of the Indies employee, awaited her arrival in Louisiana. Neither property nor free status protected Marie Baud from the everyday uncertainties of this Atlantic world. alongside sailors and slaves, she endured a grueling journey many did not survive. When she arrived on the Gulf Coast, trading company agents detained her, claimed she owed the company duties on her slaves for transporting them from Goree, and confiscated them. Her husband, John, appealed on her behalf, but the slaves were sold with others arriving on the same ship. Propertyless and living in New Orleans, La Fompinay's freedom, marital status, and racial designation took on a different meaning just through that crossing, the Traversée. So Marie Bode's journey constructs an Atlantic biography, articulating the myriad ways sex, status, gender, race, and violence unfolded during these years. Her journey from St. Louis to New Orleans occurs as these dramatic forces are creating the early French Atlantic, and how as they begin to transform the lives of women of African descent in both Africa and the Americas. She was a wife of a white artisan and trading company employee. She was born in West Africa and enjoyed free status in both Africa and the Americas. She owned property while living in coastal Senegambia, only to lose it on arrival in Louisiana. And she traveled the wider Atlantic community, connecting continental African societies to maritime commercial networks and maritime commercial networks to the Americas. So in many ways, she's an exceptional figure. At the same time, she also exemplifies this collision between imperialism, patriarchy, and bondage that occurred in the lives of women of African descent during this time period, the 18th century. Marie Bode moved through an Atlantic world of African wives, company soldiers, and slaves, African slaves. Her latitude extends horizontally from St. Louis through the Middle Passage to New Orleans, and her longitude climbs vertically through chattel slaves marked for sale, coerced labor, women of different marital status, all the way through administrators, governors, and royalty. So that when she embarks, when Marie ends up embarking from Senegambia, she leaves behind a cohort of women and a particularly multi-ethnic and polytheistic community of traders, property owners, and cultural brokers. And some people may know of Senegal and the seigneurs, and I'm actually not going to get into them in this talk necessarily, and I'm happy to talk more about that after. What I do want to get into is how her migration actually evokes a kind of transition. And that it becomes this really important piece when we're thinking about doing diasporic histories, as well as thinking about the position of African women and women of African descent in the Atlantic world. That there is one thing to think about comparisons, for example, between St. Louis and New Orleans, and a lot of my work is around that, but it's also another thing to kind of hold constant this experience of crossing, La Traversée, and what does that mean, and how does that also repackage African and African Atlantic identity on the other side of the Atlantic. And so that's what I'm going to go through today. When I normally tell this story, I tell a longer story of her life in Senegal and some of her life in Louisiana. But what I want to talk about today is that middle passage where when I encounter her in the archive, and we're here rethinking slavery, the images and archive. When I encounter her in the archive, she's simply listed in the register as La Mulatresse Passagère. Let me see if I have that. Smaller than I wanted it to be, but you can see it here. This is all you have in the register for her. And it's rather unique. You don't necessarily find that in other registers at all. So it stands out. La Mulatresse Passagère. So in 1728, Marie Bode, labeled as this only, boards the slave ship La Galatée at Goree. La Galatée had embarked from L'Orient in May of 1728 and arrived at Saint Louis somewhere near the end of June. It moors without incident and loads about 130 negs, negresses, and negrillons, so men, women, children, before proceeding to Goree. When it arrives, the appearance of this new passenger with enslaved property in tow causes the captain to write in the margins of his log, took on one Mulatresse passenger bound for Mississippi. So slave ships are the connected tissue of the Atlantic world. Technological innovations of this early modern period, their peculiar creations, part war machine, mobile prison, and factory, and this is Marduk Rediker who I'm quoting, with complex racial sexual landscapes. There were also cultural and political units, of course, that is Paul Gilroy, and maritime territories that are ruled by captains and populated by heterogeneous crews, occasional passengers, and enslaved Africans seized for sale across the Atlantic. So for the majority of Africans crossing the ocean in the 18th century, encountering the Atlantic world began on slave ships and along their itineraries. La Galatée is no different. So Marie Bode may have been the only woman of African descent on the ship who was not enslaved, but traveling with slaves, she would have been even more conspicuous. Legalité's journey was especially fraught, and I'll get into some of the layout of the ships that are crossing the Atlantic from Senegambia, Ouida, Cabinda, over to Louisiana. This journey is especially fraught. October 1728, they begin to embark for Louisiana. One of the sailors had already drowned, and another slave had died of unspecified causes. 2 days into the journey, death begins to sink into the ship. Scurvy, drowning, and a kind of unspecified general illness begins to kill several slaves and also much of the crew. On average, a slave or crew member died for nearly every day of travel between Gorée and the first stop, Le Quai, on Saint-Domingue's southern coast. Legalité arrived there in December, and at Le Quai, the captain was so concerned that he noted that all of the crew are ill and in the company building with all of the sick blacks, so he had sent most of his crew off of the ship in order to recover on shore. Legalité rests at Le Quai for several days, hiring sailors and laborers and living at the port, dealing at the port with an emergency crew for the most parts. And not so much mention is made of the slaves at this point, except when they're dying. In the end, 45 slaves and 7 of the crew actually remain in Saint-Domingue and because they were too sick to continue. So by mid-December, Legalité is back at sea. By the time the ship actually arrives on the Gulf Coast, some 90 slaves had died in total, including several of the women. So in returning to think about Marie Baud and her slaves and what they might have experienced, if they experienced any illness, there's no record of it. Women's misery aboard slave ships, however, was certainly acute. So at least 9 of the 33 slaves who died between Gorée and Le Quai were female, marked as female. Ship-wide illnesses like scurvy, they cause everyone distress, but women with scurvy may also actually have been misdiagnosed with a condition related to menstruation. Along with illness, the ocean also offers its own kind of considerable threat. Of course, there was drowning. At least one of the people who drowned was also a woman. And children often succumb to the terrors of the Middle Passage as well. So on this ship, at least 2 of the deaths were infants. And this is a loss that would have had a deep impact on everyone on board, the women included. And it's difficult to say, but the women perhaps especially. Marie Baud, of course, makes it across the Atlantic. She survives the worst of the scourge, and in this, she may have been luckier than many of the others on board. So in January, Legalité drops anchor at Belize, which is a French fort on the mouth of the Mississippi River, and at Belize, officials begin the process of merchandise brought for sale into the colony. And this includes captive Africans. And they begin to secure it for journey upriver. So you can't actually take the large ships up the Mississippi River. You have to take them in smaller canoes and smaller ships that go up. And so you end up having to wait at Belize, which is, of course, extending the experience of the Middle Passage, of Traversée. Days could pass while captains, passengers, crews, and bondspeople waited for trading company officials to meet them by riverboat. And when they finally arrive, there's concern for the health of slaves, of course. And in this case, that concern may have initially distracted them from the presence of one mulatresse and her enslaved property. The governor, in fact, lamented the loss of so many slaves to scurvy, and in his own notes and his letters to the company, and made a point to place the sickest ones, moving them as quickly as possible up to New Orleans, while the rest waited. All of the slaves sick and well would end up going to auction within about 3 days' time. And when attention did finally turn Marie Baud's way, confusion appears to have ensued. It wasn't clear, was she a slave? Was she free? What was she claiming? She was detained for a bit of a time. They ended up levying the tax, as Jean Pinet complained about. And they posed it on each of her slaves, and eventually the authorities just confiscated them, leaving her with only one petite negrite, about 5 or 6 years of age, so only one small child. And she was then forwarded hastily, they say, to New Orleans. So this is the experience of just her, and her as a free African woman on a slave ship crossing the Atlantic. She, in some ways, in this represents one of the many connections between Senegal to Louisiana. Any anxiety she may or may not have felt on embarking from one location and disembarking from the other, her fear as sickness enveloped the ship, her pleasure as the ship finally reached it and approached its destination even, all these seem to be lost in time. What we have in a lot of ways are the things that appear in the register. we also have her transformation, because when she reappears in the documentation, she is no longer, so the slave ship archive for the French Atlantic is an archives of the Marine, which is in the National Archives in Paris. She reappears in Louisiana's archives, and the C-13, which is the colonial records for Louisiana. And when she reappears, she is no longer like the mulatresse passagère, who's just sort of a name and appears in the margins of the register, but she's now La Femme Pinet, basically the wife of this guy, Jean Pinet, the gunsmith, and the impropertied wife now of a company employee. So a change had occurred as she crossed the Atlantic, and this has profound implications for her life in a new place. So how to put this in some kind of context, particularly in thinking about the broader trade between Senegal and Louisiana. It's after 1719 that women of African descent begin to arrive in Louisiana en masse. 1719 is when the first slave ships come from the continent, as far as we know, as far as extant registers will tell us. 23 French slave ships left West and West Central African coasts bound for Louisiana and arrived. Each carried men and women and children marked for sail and to be disembarked. All of them sailed under the French flag, and I only mention that because sometimes flags would switch, out of piracies, so there could have been other empires that, dropped off in Louisiana. But it was all under the French flag. Most of them arrived from Senegambia. So of those 23 ships, 16 carried slaves purchased or loaded at either Gorée or Saint-Louis or both. Another 6 arrived from Ouida, which is one of the busiest slave ports across the Atlantic trade in the Bight of Benin, and a single ship arrived from Cabinda in West Central Africa. The other thing to note is that 22 of the 23 ships arrived over the course of 11 years, and I really ought to note that a lot of this work has been done by folks like Wendell Midler Hall, and a lot of this is, thanks to the slave trade database, we can actually confirm through all the things that we know, the records that Hall went through very, very meticulously by hand. 22 of the 23 slave ships arrived over the course of 11 years. So this creates an immediate, concentrated, and critical mass of enslaved labor direct from the continent. And its population also described themselves and were described by traders and slave owners by a range of ethnic denominations: Senegal, Wolof, Sierra, Bamana from Senegambia, Mina from Benin, Congo from Cabinda. Now, ethnicity is always a fraught topic, but the reality is ethnicity is a resource that planters wish to exploit, and it was also an identity that Africans cleaved to over the course of their lives. So ethnicity actually matters. How we think about it may change, we can argue about it, but it is a thing that we need to think about. The gender distribution of Africans arriving in the colony in such a short time played a role in shaping the colony as it developed, and how that played a role is one of the questions that we are always asking and thinking about slaveholding societies. So the year 1721 actually marks the first documented arrival of female slaves shipped from Africa to Louisiana. Over the course of the French slave trade to the Gulf Coast, just over a quarter of the slaves sold in Louisiana were female. So this is not a small number, but it's not an unaccountable number. It's a number that we have to take into account when we're thinking about the formation of African society in the Gulf Coast, and if we're thinking about the flows of the slave trade. 12 of the 23 ships that made the crossing left behind enough data to calculate gender ratios among their cargo. Most of those 12 actually arrived from Senegambia. And so from that, we can get a kind of sense of what and when are women arriving in the Gulf Coast. So I don't have time to necessarily discuss the slave trade as a whole here, but I want to feature a couple of those ships and use them to kind of think through how it may be possible, even given how little we're able to glean from a slave register and what that means to glean from a slave register, how it might be possible to rethink slavery and doing histories of slavery out of this archive of free Black African female persons. So ship one. Okay, there is a slave ship. It leaves Senegal on October 29th, 1727, so you guys can read this. The death toll, as Gwendolyn Midler Hall notes, begins immediately. Dysentery, scurvy, a sailor dies of fever. At least 2 slaves die mort subite, which is sudden death of unknown description. In January, while anchored at Cay, the pilot writes that the captain put 61 sick, nègres, pièces d'un, ashore. So these are pieces, bits, portions, shards of the Indies. Passenger picked up at Senegal dies of fever somewhere around here. A cross marks the margin between the scrawl and the edge of the ledger where the slaves who have been baptized before death on shore by their owners, if owned at the comptoirs or escales, where they have expired. Nothing marks the margin for unbaptized slaves, and nine of the slaves who died were nursing babies. So when I'm going through the registers, often I'm, halfway on social media, I'm trying to think through and process what is happening and what I'm going through. One of the things we talked about yesterday is like the affective experience of going through the manuscripts. I find in some ways working with the digital sort of allows me to mediate some of this in really interesting ways. So when I was going through the registers, I popped up on my Tumblr and I tossed some of the descriptions on there. And this is one of those. There's no lie here. This is a vignette from Le Duc de Noailles. I'm just going to say Le Duc as shorthand. It loaded slaves at Saint Louis and Gorée through most of the summer, from July to November 1727, so that by January the next year, it arrives at Saint Louis du Saint-Domingue. So Le Duc had one of the highest mortality rates of the ships who did the crossing from Africa to Louisiana. Galatée had a most dramatic type of crossing, just sort of a slave. Somebody died every day. That actually was not necessarily usual. Le Duc had the highest mortality. Scurvy decimates the ship. Some 47 men, 14 women, 8 boys, 5 girls, and 9 infants end up passing away. Scurvy decimates the ship, but decisions made by the captain and the agents of the company at Saint-Domingue, where it stopped to refuel, actually ended up exacerbating the problem. Now, this is why their numbers were worse. Although Le Duc arrived at New Orleans in the dead of winter, this is January, it's New Orleans, but it's still quite frigid, the captain or the company agent had not given the slaves warm clothing at Saint-Domingue. Slaves commonly, at least in these crossings, in this particular part of the trade, were crossing unclothed, naked. So when they arrive in New Orleans in the dead of winter, still unclothed, they end up suffering the effects of the extreme weather. About 25 more slaves died, just en route from Saint-Domingue to New Orleans. And when the gender data is recorded, it's quoted solely in this way. The only way that we know of the women who might have been on the ship is by those 14 women who passed away, 14 women and 5 girls. There may have been more, of course, taken on and survived and end up in Louisiana. Now, this piece about the pieces of the Indies is always really interesting to me. The person that most people kind of come back to in thinking through that is Pierre Labat, who between 1693 and 1705 spent much of his time as a church official in places across the French Caribbean. So he's in Martinique, he's in Guadeloupe, he's also in St. Kitts, Dominica, and Grenada. And he publishes his own story of actually being on the African coast. In 1728, he publishes this, although the rumor is that he actually never set foot on the coast itself. But he does describe the tariffs at Gorée, and he describes them in these terms, pieces of the Indies, right? So he's counting as a fool if they fit a particular measure. You had to be younger than 30, older than 10, have all of your fingers, legs, toes, eyes, ears, and teeth. You could not be hunchbacked or lame. You could not otherwise seem to have a disability. You also had to be a man. If the flaws were too considerable, if you were a woman or if you were a child, the commis and the director of the company would end up rejecting you as a fool piece. But if they weren't too considerable, and considering how hungry slave trading interests were for slaves, the slaves could then sort of be, combined together. So a pièce d'un, you could use equivalents like 2 children equal to grown man, 2.5 children, 3 for 1, 3 for 2. Suckling infants didn't count at all. A large woman and a small child might actually also count for a man. So Christopher Miller calls Labat a notorious slave trading, swashbuckling pirate priest of the Dominican order, who was also a prolific and plagiarizing writer of travel accounts. He stole from everybody. He stole from Louis Chambonneau, André Bru. He stole with impunity. But it doesn't mean that his work didn't compute. It doesn't mean that these numbers actually don't apply. And it doesn't mean that slaves are not also being seen as pieces and shards that need to be then put together and fit. And in fact, what ends up working, being interesting about Labat and how he's understanding these, and how we can then take him in thinking about how we relate to the archive in these texts, is that Labat's work, these bestsellers, for their time, end up creating and solidifying a base of knowledge about Africans that becomes gospel. So when it becomes integrated into thinking into how company officials are thinking about the trade, it actually becomes, you know, a word and a calculation and a mathematics that they use to judge. Spillers has described the Middle Passages as a dehumanizing and engendering and defacing project of African persons. So in the French slave trade to Louisiana, the life cycle of this project is imagined by agents of the company and financed by investors. All of this unfolds across these kinds of letters between governors and a trading company on both sides of the Atlantic, in slave registers, in travel narratives that become encyclopedic reference points. And this push to rationalize can also be seen in these other kinds of texts that go across, back and forth across the Atlantic. I'm gonna do one more, just as a reference point. There's a slave ship. It leaves Senegal in 1726 and arrives at Belize in 4 months. It isn't quick, it doesn't stop for food or water. Slaves disembark, everything is fine. The company owns them. Private owners aren't found. So the slaves change hands, they change hands again. Within days, the private owners who have taken slaves are now taking them back. I'm just skimming through what is here. Because the slaves are all sick. Once again, scurvy. And scurvy is just, you know, it's a scourge. It's always across all of the ships, slave and not. The company or colony doesn't want them anymore, or maybe can't keep them, can't support them. And so just for these private owners, the company says, okay, well, why don't we guarantee that you can have them if they live for 30 days or more, you know, it'll be fine, and if they don't, then you can bring them back. These special pieces of the Indies are then branded with the mark of the company. Now the private owners know, and the company knows, and the colony knows, and other ship captains and the sailors who survived the trip, and the Catholic nuns know, and other slaves know, and the Maroons in the Cypress Swamp know, and the Chickasaw Natchez Huma know that these slaves are special. They came sick, but they are guaranteed. Special brands for special hands, for special blacks, and for special deaths. So this is the log of the Venus. It traded slaves for Senegal's only for a month. The goal was to get slaves across the Atlantic as quickly as possible, April 1728. And this is another one where the gender data is only available because of the dead. So we know 7 died along the way, 5 of them were women, and we know 14 boys died. One of the reasons I end up picking this one out is because it's not often that you get to get a sense of brandings and how those operate. To bring this to a close, one of the things that I like to think about with Marie Baud is that settled in New Orleans, of course, she's no longer this property-free African woman in this community of wealth, race, and status. She's not nameless, so she's not propertyless, she's not branded. She's not necessarily sick, at least as far as we don't know. She's kind of this thing in between. She's La Femme Pinée. She's the wife of a French artisan in this overseas colony, where the majority of women of African descent are coming across and having these kinds of experiences, and where slavery ends up getting linked to bondage and servitude. So in 1731, just to bring us way back to Marie Baud, Jean Pinet is marked as living downriver from the city with an unnamed wife, with 5 black slaves or servants, and at least 1 white servant. He ends up dying in 1737, and we don't have more record, at least right now, of what becomes of her. We have a slight record of what might have become of one of her slaves that she brought across the Atlantic when a woman named Louise Bertiche, Bertiche is a kind of common name in the Senegal context, gets sold to the charity hospital. But outside of that, what we know about Marie Baud reveals us something about what you get from the Atlantic travel, what women are experiencing, but also tells us something also as much as what we don't know. And what we don't know, and those silences and those missing spaces are actually can be really, really productive. And they can also tell us something about how to rethink and how to situate La Traversée in this conversation about free African women on one side and women of African descent who are enslaved on the other. So I will leave it there.
Thank you. Okay, so this morning I want to present to you what is the initial blush of a new project. I've been working mostly on early modern Brazil for the past 4 or 5 years, and so I'm moving a little bit forward in time, and so this talk will be primarily focused on the 19th century, starting in the 19th century, but obviously with a relevance to the past. So I want to talk to you a little bit about today, something that I came across while I was doing research for my my book that will be coming out soon. And one of the biggest questions is, one, Brazil, how many of you know that Brazil was the last country to abolish slavery in the Western Hemisphere? How many of you knew that? And so what year was that? Anybody? There's so many historians in the room. 1888. So Brazil became the last country in the Western Hemisphere to abolish slavery. And so many have sort of speculated why. And while I was going through the archive and working on a different project, I was struck by something that I came across by what he's called the leader of, one of the founding leaders of the Brazilian abolitionist movement, Joaquim Nabuco. And in this sort of, in this piece that he writes in this book called Abolitionism, Abolicionismo, he targets free blacks. He specifies that free blacks were one of the primary impediments to slave emancipation in Brazil. And I thought that was pretty strange. So why is it that free blacks were an impediment to the abolition of slavery in Brazil? And so with that being said, this talk is going to be divided into two parts. I'm going to be looking at one, how were enslaved blacks and free blacks part of sustaining slavery and reproducing white supremacy through the eyes of one, European travel writing. And number two, I'm going to be looking at it through the lens of literature, through an Afro-Brazilian. I probably should not call him Afro-Brazilian because he didn't refer to himself as that during his lifetime. People refer to him as a mulatto writer, Machado de Assis, that I work on quite a bit. And in his work, he has a very profound, very interesting vignette about a black slaveholder, a recently liberated black who then purchases a slave and how he treats his slave. So this is just to kind of give you sort of the foundation for what I'm going to be discussing. So I'm going to start off with some of the historical facts of where sort of Brazil were and free blacks were, the position of free blacks were in the 19th century. By the early 19th century, Brazil had the largest number of free blacks in the Americas. This population was comprised of both women and men and was interracially diverse in its makeup. Whereas the United States, the free population was roughly 95% white, in Brazil, whites comprised only half of the free population in Brazil. Brazil's first national census in 1872 indicates that the free black population was comprised of about 4.2 million. Now, this is obviously, any of you know about Brazil and census data, we can't really trust it very much, particularly because there was a great degree of confusion around how people racially identified. I don't have time to get into that right now, but if some of you have questions about that, we can answer that in the Q&A. Brazil's first national, by the end of the century, Brazil had the largest black population in the Western Hemisphere. British Reverend Robert Walsh, who lived in Brazil from 1828 to 1829, remarked that the black population in Brazil was, quote, beyond all ordinary calculation, so much so that his eye was, quote, was so familiarized with black faces that the occurrence of a white face in the streets of some parts of town struck me as a novelty. With emancipation on the horizon, the nation wrestled with the meaning of black freedom and its implications for a multiracial society, in which whites were now a minority and the status of free blacks was changing in perplexing ways. As historians Francisco Vidal Luna and Herbert Klein point out, though free blacks were integrated in many sectors of Brazilian society, especially in terms of economic mobility, Brazil was still, quote, all like all other American slave regimes, and quote, by its very nature racist, and the white elite discriminate in various ways against free persons of color, even as it permitted a very active level of manumission. Over the course of Brazilian history, black Brazilians had become intimately and paradoxically tied to every area of Brazilian society, including reproducing and sustaining slavery alongside the white elite, which is the focus of this paper. In the 19th century, a number of free mulattoes and blacks had risen to become prominent lawyers, doctors, and government officials, artisans, and writers, but some of these free black Brazilians also became slaveholders, slave torturers, and slave catchers, which I'll be discussing shortly. While Brazil's free black population was steadily increasing, the idea of including all blacks as citizens in the newly established nation proved to be a source of extreme contradiction, disquiet, and violence. For white slaveholders, the question was, how could they hold on to their privileged status with the inevitability of abolition and retain control over the black masses? Blacks faced more complex questions about racial identity and affiliation as they attempted to negotiate the transition from slavery and freedom. Free blacks and mixed race Brazilians saw an opportunity to take part in whiteness, but for this they needed the consent of whites. Blacks, whites, and mulattoes participated together in devising a new social order, social rules around race that were unique to Brazil, at times incongruous, permitting the illusory transformation of blacks into whites and never far away from the origins of slavery and white supremacy. By 1875, 3/4 of Brazilian blacks had either purchased their freedom or had been freed by their owners. Through Brazilian system of social whitening, a number of these free blacks and mulattoes became legally designated as white and were allowed to access the privileges of whiteness. So this was something that was very unique to Brazil. I don't know how many of you are aware of this. We don't have time to really go into sort of the structure of social whiteness, but this was something that was very unique to Brazil. Upon being emancipated, some free blacks, blacks and mulattoes could legally go and change their race and be legally designated as white. So this complicates things a lot because you have people that were slaves, that were born black and enslaved, but then become white. So again, that's how I say that sort of the census data becomes very complicated because it becomes all about how people want to identify themselves versus how we might identify them today. While in the United States, race was determined by skin color or the one drop rule. And so the one drop rule does not exist in Brazil. And so this is one of the primary differences between Brazil and the United States. So here in the United States, if you have one drop of black blood, you're black. In Brazil, it's a little bit fuzzier than that. In Brazil, a person's condition of freedom or profession could grant whiteness. And so if you were a lawyer, for example, if you were able to become educated, if you were able to become a professor, for example, you would be legally designated as white. And people would respect that and say, okay, he wants to be white, okay, we'll accept that. The system of social whitening required that blacks give up affiliations with other blacks, and whites controlled the terms of their integration into white society. Really quickly, one of the things I want to say about this is that there was no sort of, what was very interesting that I found in doing this research is that there was no sort of even for mulattoes and mixed race people, there was no sort of biracial identity. It was either you were one or the other. And so in sort of assuming this white identity, you had to choose which side you were going to be on. Were you going to be white? Were you going to be black? In many cases, that sort of impacted their participation in slavery and sort of the emancipation of slavery. So you had to choose sides. So you couldn't be socially white and have an affiliation with enslaved people at the same time. So you had to pick sides. Okay, in that sense, social whitening actually maintained traditional racial boundaries and white domination. It indicated neither a new social order nor a racial democracy as Brazil would once sort of masquerade itself as. Moreover, it expressly served to create divisions and hostility among blacks, making insurrections that whites feared less likely. This is sort of a divide and conquer technique. This system greatly contributed to the late abolition of Brazilian slavery. Bahian mulatto abolitionist who actually identified as very an educated man who actually identified as black during the time, in 1887, wrote that the important roles in slavery were the feitor das fazendas, or the overseer, the slave catcher who retrieved runaways, and the slave punisher and slave torturer, the corretor de escravos. These positions were mostly occupied by white men and other slave societies, but were held exclusively by free and formerly black men in Brazil. Fonseca writes, certainly, quote, two-thirds of individuals who descend to such a noble task are in the provinces of Bahia. He's working in Salvador da Bahia. And probably in the whole country, black are black or men of color. These positions allow them to become integrated as well as intimately tied to the violence of slavery. In addition to the black and mulatto slave catchers, Englishman Henry Costa relates that the slave whiffer, even in his condition of enslavement, became part of an interracial slave hierarchy. Costa describes how black slave whippers' allegiance as master was often exacted in the form of even more extreme cruelty toward other slaves than perpetrated by whites. The position that free blacks found themselves in the wake of abolition was essentially a choice between black and white and slavery and freedom. But on some level, we can see that free and socially white blacks and mulattoes assumed such positions, such as capitães do mato, overseers and public slave whippers through which they inflicted violence upon other blacks were a way of not only disassociating themselves from blacks and performing whiteness, but also performing freedom interracially. And so this is a very important thing. So it's not about just sort of becoming, assuming this white identity. So I'm really interested in how exactly this socially white identity, even in the context of slavery, how do you perform it? How do you make people recognize it? How do you prove to white people, to sort of the white elite, that you are in solidarity with them? And then how do you disassociate yourself from enslaved people? And oftentimes, as some of the chroniclers write, this took the form of violence. And so it had to be manifested in a way, in a very physical way. And so this is what, in other words, it was not only important to be accepted into the ranks of whites to solidify one's identity as an intraracial other, it was equally important to be seen by blacks as an other. So this recognition was very important. I want to shift now to the painting behind me. How many of you have seen this painting before? Yes, the historians have seen it. Johann Moritz Hugendes' lithograph, Punition publique sur la place Sainte-Anne, Public Punishments in St. Anne's Square, depicts a black male slave who is disrobed and tied to a post and is being savagely beaten by a slave whipper. So you can kind of see this right here, right in the middle. Most likely a former slave himself. At the right sits another slave who is visibly weakened from having been beaten and is being helped by a black woman. The violent scene of slave torture is a public spectacle. Well-dressed white men, possibly slave masters, sit in the front of the crowd and watch with fascination and anticipation as the slave whipper tortures the slave for their pleasure. The slave whipper, well aware that he is an essential part of the spectacle, dramatically raises his hand to inflict an exacting blow to the body of the fettered slave. In the following passage, Expedi, a Frenchman who also lived in Brazil, describes the torture of slaves by black slave whippers. He writes, "The victim is laid between two planks. Ropes are used to tie him by the feet, hands, and torso. The whipper, always a free African, takes the whip. This instrument is composed of five small woven strips, a foot and a half long, attached to a wooden handle. The African whips the slave back until the overseer orders him to stop. Then the victim's wounds are bathed with a mixture of water, salt, and vinegar, and it's over. The tormentor can start again a few days later when the slave has healed." Here we note the cynical care given to the slave's wounds to prepare him for his next whipping. Upon receiving freedom, the formerly enslaved had no control over how they were integrated and the extent to which they were included in Brazilian society. Many paintings, novels, and travel journals produced during the period document the use of free blacks as agents of torture and violence against the enslaved. White supremacy in many instances dictated how black freedom would be registered and archived. This mechanism also functioned as a means for the white elite to control how they themselves would be depicted for posterity in relation to slavery. The integration of free blacks into white society via the creation of occupations such as public slave whippers and capitães do mato was calculated to serve white elite sustaining black, while sustaining black oppression. Black freedom became paradoxically entrenched in maintaining slavery, and the assertion of black freedom became intimately tied to reproducing white supremacy. In turn, the comportment of free blacks towards slaves impacted how the enslaved viewed those who had been freed and what it meant to be free. And so this was a very important tactic in reproducing sort of conflict in among black people. And so this was further sort of exacerbating the division between free black people and enslaved people. And so in many cases, enslaved people did not see free blacks as allies. And in fact, they, in many cases, some write that they were perhaps more dangerous because they sort of exploited, in many cases, that connection between, that racial connection, but they were working to serve the interests of white supremacy. But by doing the dirty work of the white masters, these black torturers became hyper-visible. And in this moment, they came to take on the face of slavery, of both its violence and criminality, in the place of the white slaveholder. And so what you see here is that, what's very interesting about this painting that's very popular is that you see an image of a black person beating another black person. And so this is very, so when you sort of think about slavery, it was very interesting how strategic they were about creating images that would later be found sort of in the archive to sort of say, hey, there's something different going on here. There's something different going on in Brazil. Slavery is not just black and white. Black people are also able to participate in slavery. This was sort of one of the leading reasons why many people said, hey, slavery doesn't need to be abolished because black people are able to do just as much as we are. Free blacks are able to participate in slavery in many cases in the same way that whites are. So a very cynical sort of rationale, but this was the reality. This dynamic calls attention to the spectacularity of black freedom while camouflaging the role of the white master in slave torture. The so-called fluid racial basis of Brazilian slavery was maintained by white control over violence toward blacks. When and which forms of violence were used and became visible and documented, and when it was hidden or erased. One of the distinctive characteristics of Brazilian slavery also is the existence of numerous free black and mulatto slaveholders. This was also in the case in places such as Haiti. There were, and actually, John Hope Franklin writes a small piece about a small portion of black slaveholders actually in, I believe in North Carolina, he writes, and it's actually in a small footnote, but. They existed. Many prominent blacks descended from free slaveholding families, and some blacks and mulattoes purchased slaves to serve in their household. German traveler Wilhelm von Esching noted that, quote, the free mulatto also possesses slaves. He lives with his arms crossed and considers work an undignified thing. Slave ownership was a possibility for all free people, but only a minority of the black population could afford slaves. However, a number of sources, as we will see, indicate that slave ownership extended beyond class lines and was not merely relegated to the extremely wealthy, even allowing those who were technically enslaved to own slaves of their own. And so there's very interesting accounts, particularly from European travelers who were really surprised that there were even blacks, enslaved blacks who were actually, had been enslaved all of their lives, who had saved money, and one of the things that they did was to buy their own slave. So this is very strange. So you actually have enslaved black people. There's actually a case of a mulatto slave who actually tried to purchase his own freedom, and he was denied. And so he took that money and then bought his own slave. He was actually reported as being one of the cruel slave masters. And this is from the northeastern region of Pernambuco. One of the fathers of the Brazilian abolitionist movement, as I said at the beginning of the talk, went as far as to argue that the existence of black slaveholders was yet another proof of racial equality. He remarked that a black, quote, even in the darkness of slavery could buy slaves, perhaps even, who knows, a son of his former master. This fact, according to Nabuku, proved, quote, the fluidity of the classes and individuals and the unlimited extent of the exchanges between slaves and free men who constitute the majority of Brazilian citizens. And so this was sort of used as an argument, again, we don't need to abolish slavery because blacks can even own slaves in Brazil, which was not, it was not the entirety of the black population, but a portion, if you had enough money, you could. Koster also relates that blacks' experience of having suffered enslavement did not necessarily temper their treatment of slaves. Rather, they sometimes proved to be even more violent than the white master. He writes, it is likewise frequently observed that even manumitted Africans who become possessed of slaves, which occasionally occurs, treat them in a severe and unfeeling manner. That is nothing softened, but rather rendered more violent by a remembrance of their own suffering. Likewise, X.P. Lee writes of formerly enslaved African women that in, quote, cruel, their cruelty surpasses that of whites, and she becomes a merciless mistress for the slaves she owns, end quote. Slavery on scholarship on slavery in the Americas examined at length the role of the slave in the construction of the white master identity and the participation of Africans in the transatlantic slave trade. But the existence of black slaveholders poses a more complicated question. What was the purpose and meaning, what purpose and meaning did the slave hold for the formerly enslaved turned master? How did black masters assert their authority over people of their own race when the line distinguishing them from their slaves was so tenuous? When skin color did not readily distinguish them as free or enslaved? I'd like to shift now to, as I said, I'm going to finish very quickly, Machado de Assis' 1881 novel entitled The Posthumous Memoirs of Brás Cubas. And in this, as I presented at the beginning of the talk, is a short snippet, a chapter entitled The Whipper, he calls it. And he writes an encounter between a former master who freed his slave, and he hasn't seen his slave in about 20 years. And one day he's walking through the streets of Rio and he sees this big commotion, and it just happens to be his former slave who has now become a slave owner. And so he writes, I saw a black man whipping another in the square. The other one didn't try to run away. He only moaned these words, please, I'm sorry, master. Master, I'm sorry. But the first one paid no attention, and each entreaty was answered with a new lashing. Take that, you devil, he was saying. There's your sorry, you drunk. Master, the other one moaned. Shut your mouth, you animal, the whipper replied. I stopped and looked. Good Lord. And who did the one with the whip turn out to be? None other than my old slave and houseboy, Prudencio. The one my father had freed some years before, he came over to me having ceased immediately and asked for my blessing. I inquired if the black was his slave. He is, yes, master. Here he's reverting back to being a slave. So he's a slave master, but then he's sort of, you see him sort of reverting back to, he's a free man and a slave master, but still sort of, he's still not equal. And so a person who's socially white, they're still not equal, and so he still has to acknowledge his whiteness. What did he do? He's a bum and a big drunk. Only today I left him in the store while I went downtown, and he went off to a bar to drink. It's all right, forgive him, I said. Of course, master, your word is my command. Get on home. From outside, the Valongo Street episode was dreadful, but only on the outside. As soon as I stuck the knife of rationality deeper into it, I found it to have a happy, delicate, and even profound marrow. It was the way Prudencio, this is the former slave turned master, had to rid himself of the beatings he'd received by transmitting them to someone else. So this is how they justify sort of black the cruelty of black masters to how they treat other slaves. This is how they justify it. As a child, I used to ride on his back and put a bit into his mouth and whip him mercilessly. He would moan and suffer. Now that he was free, however, he had the free use of his arms, his legs. He could work, rest, sleep, unfettered by his previous status. Now he could make up for everything. He bought a slave and was paying him back with high interest the amount he'd received from me. This depiction of a formerly enslaved slaveholder written by a mulatto author provides critical insight to Machado himself and the white elite that he depicted in his works, viewed black slaveholders and their relationship to the enslaved. The above scene shows how public physical violence served as a means to distinguish the conditions of freedom and enslavement. The narrator interprets Prudencio's violent behavior toward his slave as meaning that he has somehow is somehow dealing with his own pain and trauma. This description, as Henry Koster's observations of black slaveholders, suggests that the racial trauma of black slaveholders as part of a multiracial society was dealt with and released intraracially through violence, and that this violence against slaves constituted a form of catharsis. So this is what I found extremely interesting. And so this is not sort of the trauma of slavery is not sort of taken out interracially, but intraracially. This is violence, black on black violence is sort of seen by as a form of catharsis by white Brazilians and by European observers. And so this is sort of seen cynically as sort of the bright side of slave ownership. In beating and humiliating his slave in public, Prudencio calls attention to himself, showing the gathering crowd that he is a property owner, a master. Part of the logic of the performance that is inherent to social whiteness is the public recognition by whites to create this illusory difference between Prudencio and his slave. Black freedom and social whiteness, in order to be legitimated, depended on a public show of violence toward other blacks that must be visibly recognized by whites. So it's not about just, I'm free, I'm socially white, you have to perform this. Whites have to see it, blacks have to recognize it also. And so it becomes a very, as you see in the painting also, this spectacle becomes very important to proving your solidarity and what side you're on. In this chapter, Machado reflects the attitudes of white slaveholders and the Brazilian elite who might have seen slaves' happy ending and their ability to become slave masters and inflict their own pain onto slaves. The scene calls attention to Joaquin Nabuco's comments that the possibility of the blacks owning slaves were proof of the absence of racism in Brazil. The hypervisibility of interracial violence in the context of slavery and arguably beyond came to obscure the white supremacist mechanisms that structured it. That is to say, even though white supremacy was the basis of slavery and was a system built by whites to benefit them, they were able to distance, if not remove themselves entirely from being the creators of the conditions under which this particular form of violence came into existence. Black on black violence and conflict between free and enslaved blacks became intimately linked to how elite white Brazilians substantiated their benevolent position towards slaves as part of the myth of Brazil's exceptional slavery. And so, you know, again, many of you who might be aware of the myth of racial democracy says that, you know, in Brazil, even during slavery, there was no racism. And reports, the literature written at the time says that slavery in Brazil was founded on differences and very, you know, and whatever differences they think they're talking about, but it's not founded on race. And they think under Brazilian slavery, this kind of intraracial violence that was allowed to occur created this sort of very exceptional form of slavery that was unlike any other slave society in the world. With this logic, white slaveholders exculpated themselves of the heinous acts committed against blacks under slavery. Their crimes became overshadowed by the hypervisibility of black people perpetrating acts of violence against one another. And so I'm going to end there, and I think I'm over time, but we can discuss more during the Q&A. Thank you very much.
So I'm grateful to be here as well, and I'm grateful that Jasmine invited me. What Lamont's been talking about has many congruences with my own research. I have just finished a 700-page book entitled Work, Privilege, and Class in American Slavery, subtitled Slave Narrative Testimony, 1840 to 1865. Hallmark of scholarship on antebellum African-American slave narratives has been sustained inquiry into what I would call caste, that is, white over black power distributed vertically in a hierarchical manner. Unlike Brazil, there's no black people who can become white in North America. They can't do that unless they are somehow managed to pass for white. So according to the caste system, the people who call themselves white get to define everybody else as well. And everybody who's not white is in a different caste. Scholars of slave narratives have developed a finely tuned sense of the role of caste in these narratives. At least in the antebellum narratives, there's been very little study of slave narratives after 1865, except for Up From Slavery. But research is still rudimentary insofar as class-based differences and dynamics in these narratives are concerned. So we have race, gender, but practically no class when it comes to the study of antebellum slave narratives, or postbellum for that matter. Nevertheless, within famous as well as largely forgotten slave narratives throughout the 19th century, the presence, function, and effects of class, that is, higher and lower social strata among the enslaved of the South, as well as among Southern whites, remain largely uncharted intellectual territory. I'm trying to chart that territory in this 700-page book. And the reason why it's so long is, number one, nobody's really paid much attention to class. And number two, I'm not satisfied to talk about class in relation to the 8 or 10 most popularly known texts by fugitive slaves in the pre-Civil War period. My book deals with 60 separately published slave narratives published between 1840 and 1865, which is the international heyday of the African-American slave narrative nationally and internationally. Most of these narratives have received either no attention or have received only minimal attention. So to give you a few examples just of the names of these people, household names. Henry Watson, narrative in 1848. Lunsford Lane, 1842. James Watkins, 1852 and 1860. Aunt Sally, her name was Sally Williams. Her narrative is entitled Aunt Sally, published in 1858. Israel Campbell, 1861. Francis Frederick, 1863, and the list goes on. These are people who publish separate narratives. They're all on my Documenting the American Slave website, North American Slave Narratives. They're all there and a lot more like them. So to realize the importance of class as well as caste in these 60 slave narratives, I began by reviewing what historians of American slavery have said about class among the enslaved. From John W. Blassingame and George P. Rawick in the 1970s to Deborah Gray White, Michael A. Gomez, Stephen Hahn, and of course, Ira Berlin, historical scholarship has shown how class systems, social divisions, pecking orders, and classism evolved among the enslaved, as did an awareness among the enslaved as well as their enslavers of what it meant to be higher or lower in these class divisions, these pecking orders. Most scholars of slave narratives know that enslaved domestic workers who lived within their enslavers' domiciles often had advantages as well as disadvantages that differentiated them from enslaved agricultural workers, so-called field hands, who lived in the Negro quarters. My research explores these differences as they appear in antebellum narratives. But the majority of those who produced slave narratives in the antebellum era did not come from the majority of enslaved workers. That is, those who labored from canned seed to cant 5.5 or 6 days a week in the agricultural economy that sustained the Southern slaveocracy. The most widely read slave narratives then and now were produced by men and women who portrayed themselves as skilled workers. Frederick Douglass Calker, William Wells Brown, ship steward, William Craft, cabinet maker, probably a waiter as well. Harriet Jacobson, Ellen Craft, seamstress. James W.C. Pennington, the most famous fugitive slave before Douglass, blacksmith. And foreman, AKA slave driver, Josiah Henson, Jermaine Logan, Solomon Northup, Henry Bibb was also a driver for a while. These are are important aspects of the lives of these men and women when they were enslaved, but very few studies of slave narratives pay any attention to the work these people did. But what were slaves, but primarily workers? And not to pay attention to the work that they did, which defined their lives in so many ways, is simply a big mistake, in my opinion. It's just a huge ignoring of something that needs much more attention. So we have to pay attention to the roles that work, status, and class played in the development of slave narratives, individual self-estimates, social views, and personal values. So for my purposes, class among the enslaved refers mainly to two kinds of socioeconomic differences. Differences based on access to and or control of material resources, such as money, property, and compensation of various kinds for labor. And secondly, differences based on access to or control of social power and prestige based on factors such as occupation, wage earning, family status, and literacy. I agree with Barbara Fields, a historian who's certainly influenced my work, when she defines class at its core. Class refers to a material circumstance, the inequality of human beings from the standpoint of social power. Slave narratives show that social power was among the most intangible, and yet when marshaled strategically, among the most effective means by which an enslaved individual, family, or occupational group could exert pressure on and sometimes gain privileges from dominant persons on either side of the color line in slavery. Sometimes the social power of class could serve as a fulcrum for various degrees of freedom, even within the bonds of slavery. And it's not by accident that most of the people who wrote narratives of their escape from slavery before 1865 came from the higher echelons of slavery. That's not accidental. Antebellum slave narratives testify to a variety of factors that affected the class awareness, self-estimate, and social views and values of individual slave narrators. Chief among the social factors influencing class among the enslaved are these: the type of work one did while enslaved. Why wouldn't it? It influences the type of class identity that most of us have in this world today. It's not that different for people who are enslaved. Where one lived while enslaved, particularly whether you live in town or you don't live in town. If you live in town or you live in a larger urban area, you're in a different class from people who are living in a rural area and doing the kind of work that agricultural workers are obliged to do. What sorts of responsibilities and rewards one can achieve as a slave? There are different ways to gain privileges, to gain favors. Of course, if you do this, you always know that your enslaver has a quid pro quo mentality as far as this is concerned. Another factor: who are you kin to? Do you have an extended family in slavery? What does that mean? What advantages does that give you? Do these people have a way of helping you to shape your sense of identity from your earliest childhood? Your sense of belonging to a family, to a clan, can be tremendously significant in terms of your self-estimate. Finally, what sorts of dealings does a slave have with white people? Some have a great deal, some have very little. The more some people are around whites, the more they figure out how to manipulate them, especially if they understand that I have something that my enslaver wants. How can I use that to my advantage? What sort of leverage can I get by using these skills, talents, abilities, and so on, even literacy? So for instance, with regard to number two, the location of home and work, Douglas stressed the class differences between urban and rural slaves And he spoke from experience, of course, when he wrote in his 1845 narrative, "A city slave is almost a freeman compared with a slave on the plantation. He is much better fed and clothed and enjoys privileges altogether unknown to the slave on the plantation." It's an obvious statement about the difference between the classes of people who live in town and people who live in a rural area. Douglas knew, of course, because he had had both experiences himself. As an enslaved individual, he had been born on a plantation, but very early in his life, he had been sent to Baltimore. When he got to Baltimore, of course, he became a domestic slave and worked in the household of Hugh and Sophia Auld. Eventually, what did Douglas become? He became a tradesman. And as a result, he had the opportunity to join a class of enslaved people in Baltimore about whom Du Bois wrote, Du Bois wrote about tradespeople who became self-hired, that is, who were able to hire their own time. That itself was a privilege. You don't just get that. You have to lobby for that. And your master may give it to you, or he may not. But many of the slave narrators from the antebellum period were themselves self-hired slaves. So I've listed several of the names here. And this quotation from Du Bois from the Negro Artisan in 1912, "Enslaved tradesmen and artisans were especially valuable and formed usually a privileged class with a large degree of freedom. This class of Negro clients could be found in nearly all southern cities in the antebellum era. They often owned property, reared families, and lived in comfort." Well, I'm not sure how comfortable they were, but certainly their circumstances gave them advantages that people who lived in rural areas and were enslaved did not have. In my work, I use the term class awareness to characterize class views and values in antebellum slave narratives, whether they are consciously expressed in these narratives or unconsciously expressed. Class awareness, as the social theorist Anthony Giddens has explained, is not antithetical to class consciousness, but rather a developing level or stage of it. I do not argue in my book that any particular slave narrator is an example of class consciousness, but class awareness is widespread and highly individualized. It cannot make simple generalizations about the class awareness of these very individual people who wrote these narratives. Mid-century slave narrators often articulated class-inflected attitudes, values, and ideals of their own. Their narratives often characterized the class-inflected attitudes and ideals of others, black as well as white, spanning varying levels and ranks of the slavocratic social order. That doesn't mean that these narratives are in any agreement. They're all over the place. That's one reason why they're so fascinating. And I certainly would not claim that any of these people is somehow authoritative about class divisions, because if you look at them together, they sometimes don't agree with each other. Between 1840 and 1865, slave narratives articulate a high degree of caste consciousness, instanced in widespread calls for multiple forms of resistance to, conflict with, and in a few instances, revolution against America's most egregious institutionalized form of caste, that is, chattel slavery. But mid-century slave narratives bear less pronounced evidence of caste oppression interpreted as a function of class structuration. Although some narrators did see how class inequities on both sides of the color line played a role in establishing and in maintaining caste, that is, white over black, hierarchies in the United States. Scholars and critics have recognized a pattern of geographical ascent from bondage in the South to limited liberty in the North in classic mid-century slave narratives. Class mobility is central to the pattern of ascent that scholars and critics have recognized in these narratives. Douglass became exemplary partly because his story chronicled his rise from Southern slave to freedom in the North, and then his elevation from day laborer on the docks of New Bedford, Massachusetts, to white collar worker when he became a salaried lecturer for the American Anti-Slavery Society. Most slave narratives, not all, but most slave narratives published during the mid-19th century, and particularly those produced by former slaves who were skilled workers, recount socioeconomic ascent in class and or status before, as well as after, the narrators made their escapes from slavery. In other words, there's a lot of class mobility portrayed in the narratives while the narrators are themselves enslaved. So for instance, while working on the eastern shore of Maryland as an agricultural laborer, Douglass failed in his first attempted escape. But once his enslaver removed him to Baltimore, a place where Douglass said in his second autobiography was the one place, more than any other, he wanted to go, and that's where his enslaver sent him, and then gave him the opportunity to learn a trade, Douglass used these privileges as an eventual springboard for a successful escape, the second of which, of course, got him to the North. So in this case, a former agricultural worker first becomes an urban tradesman, then keeps on moving up the socioeconomic ladder until in the last months of his enslavement, he reaches the highest rung, he becomes a self-hired slave. In this respect, he has distinct class advantages over other slaves, among them deciding where and when he will work, renting his own dwelling. He does not have to live with his master any longer, which keeps him largely free from white surveillance. These advantages, of course, made it much more likely for Douglass to be able to make his escape. Harriet Jacobs's father, Elijah, was like Douglass, an enslaved urban tradesman, who his daughter remembered was considered so intelligent and skillful in his trade that on condition of paying his mistress $200 a year and supporting himself, he was allowed to work at his trade and manage his own affairs. The upper echelon extended family Jacobs grew up in afforded her a great deal of the basis on which she talks about her self-respect, which is so important in terms of empowering her to continue the war of my life, as she called it. It's very much steeped in pride of clan, particularly in the pride that her formidable grandmother, Molly Hornyblow, had in her favorite granddaughter. Hornyblow herself proves how expert she was in knowing when and how to marshal her own status and social power when she needed them the most. Taking seriously what antebellum slave narratives tell us about class among the enslaved can help us to understand things about the experience of slaves along class lines that they hint at and sometimes speak of directly, but which, as far as I can tell, have not been examined before. For instance, consider this statement in the narrative of the life and adventures of Henry Bibb. The distinction among slaves is as marked as the classes of society are in any aristocratic community, some refusing to associate with others whom they deem to be beneath them in point of character, color, condition, or the superior importance of their respective masters. I've never seen anybody write about this or talk about this or even cite this. Or consider this statement. I don't have this particular statement, but when Harriet Jacobs speaks of her grandmother and the pride that she had in her, she writes, quote, "It was a source of pride to her," that is Molly Hornyblow, that I had not degraded myself like most of the slaves, unquote. The idea that most of the slaves in Edenton had degraded themselves, that is, bore some sort of responsibility for their supposed moral and sexual degradation, is but one facet of a much larger complex of class-inflected values and behaviors in incidents, and a large number of other antebellum narratives in which moral distinctions and social differentiation among the enslaved are treated as mutually reinforcing. Another undiscussed feature of class awareness in these narratives is the practice on the part of a number of the narrators of drawing class-inflected distinctions between the minority few who risked everything to escape and the majority of the enslaved who didn't. Fugitive slave Austin Stewart contrasted fugitives in Canada to Southern bondmen in this way. These fugitives, that is, in Canada, may be thought of to be a class of poor, thriftless, illiterate creatures like the Southern slaves. But it is not so. They, that is, the Canadian fugitives, are no longer slaves, many of whom have been many years free men, and a large number were never slaves. They are a hardy, robust class of men, very many of them men of superior intellect, and men who feel deeply the wrongs they have endured. Distinctions Stewart draws in this instance in his autobiography from 1857 contrast a fugitive minority with all those Southern slaves whom he classes as poor, thriftless, and illiterate creatures, points, I think, to also a striking kind of class awareness, and Stewart is by no means the only person who brings this out, who writes in this way. So to focus on the role of class in slave narratives, we need a class-based rather than solely a caste-based analytical method. So asking caste-based questions helps us focus on the hierarchical, white over black, vertical power, legally sanctioned power differentials between whites and blacks. But let's look at one of the most famous passages in Douglass's narrative. I have no accurate knowledge of my age, never having seen any authentic record containing it. By far the larger part of the slaves know as little of their ages as horses know of theirs. And it is the wish of most masters within my knowledge to keep their slaves thus ignorant. I do not remember to have ever met a slave who could tell of his birthday. They seldom come nearer to it than planting time, harvest time, cherry time, spring time, or fall time. A want of information concerning my own was a source of unhappiness to me, even during childhood. The white children could tell their ages. I could not tell why I ought to be deprived of the same privilege. I was not allowed to make any inquiries of my master concerning it. He deemed all such inquiries on the part of a slave improper and impertinent and evidence of a restless spirit. Now, this passage has certainly brought forward a great deal of commentary based on what I would call a caste-based perspective. That is, it focuses on Douglass as adult narrator and as boy inquirer, challenging his white master and the systems of racism that arrogated to whites a knowledge of the uniqueness of self symbolized in the birthday, while denying such self-knowledge to the enslaved. But if we examine this passage from the standpoint of class rather than caste alone, we ask different questions, not so much about effects as about cause. Not why the slave boy was forbidden the knowledge, but why he wanted to know in the first place. Caste was the reason he was denied the knowledge, but class seems to have been an important factor in his taking the impertinent step of even asking. Assuming the institution of slavery was designed to establish and maintain a fixed caste barrier between the world of the master and the world of the slave, is it not important to ask why this particular slave boy tried to breach those barriers? If Douglass, during all his years of enslavement, never met a slave who could tell of his birthday, why did this boy want so badly to know his? Why could this boy not understand why he ought to be deprived of the same privilege that the white children had? Who were these white children, anyway? And why did this little slave boy have so much access to them that he knew that they knew that they had birthdays? These are the kinds of questions that a class-based perspective would allow us to ask. It would allow us to assess unofficial, often shifting, sometimes contested social relations in the narratives that differentiate one enslaved person from another, or a minority of slaves from a majority. What is Douglass telling us about himself when he wrote in My Bondage and My Freedom, I was not the only boy on the plantation that might have been sent to live in Baltimore. There was a wide margin from which to select. There were boys younger, boys older, and boys of the same age belonging to my old master, some at his own house, some at his farm, but the high privilege fell to my lot. A class-based inquiry probes Douglass's antebellum autobiographies for answers as to what the granting of this high privilege tells us about Frederick Bailey, perhaps about his extended Bailey family, and their status among the enslaved on Edward Lloyd's, as well as Aaron Anthony's Eastern Shore farms. This is my final paragraph. 19th century slave narratives show how the dividing edge of class among the enslaved could cut two ways. Sometimes class separated upper and lower echelon slaves, drawing some slaves closer to their masters, the providers of rewards and privilege, and in some cases, the guarantor of a slave's continuing higher echelon status. On other occasions, however, the pride, self-esteem, and ambition also associated with class pitted higher echelon slaves against their supposed white benefactors for reasons that these slaveholding benefactors, so-called, could not foresee, could not understand until it was too late. A slave striving for material resources and social power might undermine the solidarity of an enslaved community, leading to envy, resentment, and alienation of the more privileged from the less privileged. This is also in the narratives. But under other circumstances, strivings and aspirations could convince the slave that he or she was justifiably superior to his status as a slave or her status as a slave, even a comparatively privileged status. Only complete, total, and permanent freedom could ever satisfy such people. The 19th century slave narrator's ideas about class were as fluid, dynamic, and subject to individual shaping as were the same narrator's ideas about race and gender, only makes their narratives all the more impressive, instructive, and fascinating for students of slavery and these autobiographies of the once enslaved. Thank you.
Sort of comprehensive study that you have of the slave narratives, if you've been able to extrapolate any sort of ideas about how gender mediated class awareness. And in Professor Adrian, your paper, in your work more generally, I'm wondering how gender mediated these violent performances of whiteness. So one might imagine that women perform violence in more intimate spaces or in different spaces that would kind of I don't know how you would square that maybe with this idea of spectacle and like kind of public with things that you describe. So.
In some regions there were more actually free black women who purchased slaves than men. There's very little, there isn't a substantial amount written on actually what was their interaction between them and their female slaves. However, there are a number of, I cited one example, and in many cases, the European observers that did see interactions between the black slave mistresses and their female slaves and even their male slaves, they essentially said that they were they were equally as cruel as the men. And so gender did not necessarily again soften sort of the violence between slave and slave mistresses and the and female slaves. One of the things that I found very interesting is that, again, this is the same argument that's also made about white slave mistresses, that they were you have a number of Brazilian chroniclers at the time and European chroniclers that say that white slave mistresses were even more cruel than white slave masters. And this is also, this appears in Harriet Jacobs as well. This appears in a number of different slave narratives that are produced. And so I think that on the one hand, while we can say that it's important to kind of look at gender, but I think it's what's interesting is to look at the sort of white black slave mistresses and black slave masters sort of and put the two in conversation and see very much that they saw themselves as property owners. I think to the first part of your question, yes, this the difference between the two would be that this violence was performed in more intimate spaces within the domestic sphere, which is potentially why we don't have as many examples of this. However, one of the most famous slave mistresses, as some of you may know, is the 18th century Brazilian slave woman Chica da Silva. Became the mistress of one of the richest men in Brazil, and at the time, and as a result, acquired a massive amount of slaves. And it's reported that she was not as she was in no means gentler toward her slaves than white slave masters would be. So I think it's important to think about that black women also saw themselves as property owners, just as any white slave master or black man, formerly enslaved black man turned slave master would have seen themselves. So I think you're right in the sense that the distinction would be what forms of violence became visible, and again, you know, depicted in artwork and in literature that we have access to today. That violence between black slave mistresses and female slaves and male slaves might have been more obscured because of its place within the domestic sphere. So,
can I ask a follow-up question? So I'm thinking about the image that you put up.
Yeah.
Do you find images of black women or white women, slave owners, who are doing the same thing? Or is there a kind of, is there a performance in the visual culture of slavery in Brazil, in that archive, of women enacting that kind of violence also? Mm-hmm. Or is that obscured in the domestic space?
That's a great question. Actually, you don't see as many images of that. There are very few people that have actually were even willing to even write about it. Because on the one hand, you know, it's especially the two of you who are specialists in slavery specialists. As you know, there was sort of this conflicting image, particularly about with respect to white women. They had to kind of contend with this image of this construction of white female virtue. Mm-hmm. And so, in many cases, there were some people that were, and this was very much linked to the image of the nation, sort of the sort of the white female virtue, the pious white woman, the woman, the white mistress who was very much benevolent toward their slaves. And so in many cases, some people weren't really even willing to acknowledge that white slave mistresses abused their female slaves as well as their male slaves physically and sexually. And so there's very, you know, people are not willing to really address that. What you do see is you see European chroniclers who were invited to stay in the homes of elite white Brazilians, and they, snooping around, wrote about this, and to the chagrin of the Brazilian white elite, went back to Europe and basically told their business. And so that's how we kind of have a glimpse of this. But, you know, even these images, you know, that we see today, I mean, these are, again, travelers kind of just painting and writing what they see. But, you know, yes, absolutely. I think that a lot of it was camouflage. A lot of they intentionally tried to hide it. And exactly why I think you they had an investment in maintaining this image of white womanhood that oftentimes masked the violence that happened within the domestic sphere, which was enormous, and you know, and Harriet Jacobs is one of the incidents in the life of a slave girl, is one of my favorites, I think, that led me even to examine this, that, you know, again, you see that they were equally as violent. It did not, gender in no way sort of tempered the violence between women and their slaves. They were property owners, and they treated them in the way that they often saw their husbands. Their husbands, their brothers, their fathers treat their slaves, and they also, and this is what a lot of my book that's coming out soon is looking at, particularly the intragender dynamics that often go are often overlooked because we're a lot of most of slavery, we're mostly sort of thinking about this kind of, you know, man, this sort of man-woman dynamic, but we often overlook what was sort of happening between sort of between women. And a lot of times, you know, just to wrap up, a lot of times people were not interested in writing about it. They didn't want to expose it. They knew that it was happening. As a result, we have the words of some European chroniclers that kind of leave us with this archive to kind of talk about it today. Mm-hmm.
There is so much in these narratives about gender on both sides of the color line. Mm-hmm. Part of my book is about the ways that the narratives portray class among white people in the South, so that repeatedly, repeatedly the chief point of attack by mid-century slave narrators against the slaveocracy is based on two things: lazy and idle. It's not how cruel they are, it's that they are the laziest people, they are the idle people, and they expect us to do all their work for them. So from standpoint of work, again, if you come at these narratives from the standpoint of work, the critique of white people is that they are lazy and idle, and they pretend to be higher class when in fact they can't take care of themselves, and we have to take care of them rather than the other way around. So the pretensions of white women to ladyhood become a real target, not only in Jacobs but in others. Henry Bibb has this great line that my mistress was so lazy she didn't have the energy to scratch her own head. You know, so there are these jibes that you see all the time. So that's the takedown on the basis of class, the way these narratives work, and the women are just as good at this. That is, women narrators, although there are very few of them, they're just as good at this as the men, but we get a lot more narratives from the men, so we know more about how the men saw these women. And it's certainly true that the from the standpoint of cruelty, Lewis Clark says in a Q&A that's at the end of his sort of a, it's not really a Q&A as much as a sort of frequently asked questions. One of them is, which is worse, the mistress or the master? Mistress every time, he says. But if we think about gender in the narratives in terms of the African American people, we have so few narratives by women before 1865. Jacobs' class experience, she makes very clear. I never had to work in the fields. I never had anybody beat me the way women who are on many plantations are at least 50% of the outdoor workforce or more. The way they have to expect this, I never had to expect that. She undergoes violence of various sorts, but she says, I did not have to experience that. The closest narrative that we have to describe the majority experience for African-American enslaved women, which was they were agricultural workers, just like the majority of enslaved African-American men, the closest we have is Sojourner Truth. That is before 1865. So with Sojourner Truth, we can see, you know, what it's like to be basically the woman of all work for her first master, a man named Dumont. You know, he puts her to work indoors, outdoors, anything he wants, she has to do. One other point, I was talking about class mobility. One of the interesting things about this narrative of Sally Williams that has never been discussed is that she figures out very early, she comes from Fayetteville, North Carolina, and she figures out very early that the way to deal with her situation as an enslaved mother is to find a way to get a white man to let her hire her time. And so she becomes a sort of entrepreneur in Fayetteville when she finds a white man who will let her do this. And she opens a small grocery store. She's a merchant. And she's very successful at this, to the point that white people in town become envious of her, the profitability of her enterprise, and they demand that she be put out of business. For the most part, class mobility for women is much more restricted than for men in these narratives. So when Jacobs goes north, she's not like Frederick Douglass or a lot of these other narrators, you know, who start out in the lower class and move up to become public intellectuals, you know, editors, lecturers, ministers, professional people. Jacobs goes north having been trained as a domestic worker, and when she gets to the north, that's what she continues doing. She does not move up one iota. And same is true for Sojourner Truth. After she renames herself Sojourner Truth and goes on her mission to speak to the people about what's been revealed to her by the Spirit, she's still cleaning houses. And she's trying her best to get the money through her sale of her likeness, her photographs, and her texts to make enough money to purchase the property that she needs to have her own home, which is exactly what Jacob says at the end of Incidents in the Life of a Slave Girl. I'm free, but the dream of my life is to have a home of my own. And when she says a home of my own, she's not talking about conventional domestic space. She's talking about property and what that means to her as an African-American woman means a whole lot that usually the notion of home doesn't come across. It's a fascinating range of experiences once we start thinking about the work that people do and what sort of work they're doing when they're enslaved, what sort of work they're doing when they get to so-called freedom, how that affects their class views and values.
I just thought about something really quickly. It's about Professor Andrews has made me think about something. I just wanted to say really quickly that in the talk I talked about, one, the need for black people, formerly enslaved blacks, to sort of distinguish themselves between themselves and to make a distinction between themselves and the enslaved. And I just thought about something Professor Andrews made me think about this, sort of in the space of the intergender between women. In the few accounts that exist, is that you see that there is that insistence on creating even more difference because, again, there's sort of there's gender and then there's race. And so there's a sort of insistence on even trying to create more of a distance between themselves and their female slaves that they sort of came into possession to. So there's a need, you know, what's interesting, is that there's a need to create difference for black people, particularly because how did you know that you were free? How did you show freedom? How did you demonstrate it? How do you embody it, particularly between people who look like you? And so particularly between black women is that you find, between black men and their slaves, there's this need to sort of make a distinction through violence to make a distinction between gender and status of free and enslaved.
I'm thinking of Harriet Jacobs and the role that sexual violence plays in the ways that the kind of sexual labor that enslaved women and enslaved men were forced to engage in, or that played a role in thinking about bondage and how that figures, and whether that's in actual like brothel situations or fancy trade, but also in the kind of position that someone like Jacobs is talking about, that positions her as an enslaved woman and wanting a space of her own as property, but also as a kind of protection. And I'm wondering how that plays into thinking about class as also a gendered category, particularly when, you know, when you can only advance so far, and the spaces you can advance are often, you know, spaces that are tinged with sexual violence and intimacy. So I'm thinking about that, and I'm also thinking about the ways that, wondering about the ways that class is gendered, also as far as thinking about masculinity. Because what was fascinating about your paper is that the whiteness that is enacted through violence is also very masculine violence, very masculine whiteness. All of those if white women and black women who are free can't access it because they're not necessarily part of the spectacle, even if they are in reality enacting the same violence, then the whiteness we're talking about that manifests itself and has to come into fruition through acts like public whippings is a violence that is in and of itself gendered masculine. So what are the ways that those also, you know, play in, or that class is gendered masculine, or that individual enslaved narratives are talking about in particular ways, the roles that, the skilled labor roles that are accessible primarily to men. I don't know, I'm thinking out loud of ways that these things can all connect, but other people can.
First of all, I thought this was a fascinating panel, and I think it's really important that we think about status distinctions among black people, even among the enslaved, and especially about how those will vary in place and time. Going to be different in different societies, different in different regions, and different over time. That's incredibly important. All of you have chosen, though, to take a primary axis of identification or axis of belonging, gender or race or class, and make that, right, the through line for your entire analysis. And I'm wondering, and I think this follows up on Professor Johnson's question, is how we articulate them together. Mm-hmm. Right? I always kind of go back to the classic Stuart Hall article, Race, Articulation, and Society Structured in Dominance, where he says, we're not choosing between class and race, right? They're always together, and gender as well, right? That seems to be very important to do in each of these projects, so that you can talk to each other, but also so we can have a full sense of how these status distinctions are made. You say they're highly individuated, with class awareness, but also gender awareness and racial awareness, right? Are working together all of the time in the way people identify and claim these kinds of different statuses, right? I was very interested in the fact that you want to use caste as an analytical category that can somehow subsume race. Presumably, you mean by that it's ascriptive and biological and exists somehow independently from the work that people do. But of course, right, the Portuguese who use the term caste, apply the term to India, right, are already talking about ascriptive differences in India that have everything to do with what kinds of roles people play in the workforce, right? What kinds of economic roles they can play, and what kinds of status distinctions they make that are already material. So caste in the origin of the word and its initial applications already is racialized, right? If we're using that way. And so I guess my frustration is, maybe this is more of a comment than a question, is that we're still kind of trying to take, you know, a single axis of identification and subsume or ignore the others, right, without trying to figure out how they interact together to create the evolution of a society and to shape its politics. That makes sense?
Yeah. I think there was a context, though. I think that was an analytic shift that they're making here. I interpreted.
Of course.
I interpreted that it was in response to absence of a kind of inquiry that really thickens notions of freedom, texturizes it. A concept I think that historians use rather promiscuously, that tell us really very little except that shackles were removed. So I think that, you know, introducing the idea of class, and I quite agree with you, and this is why I don't think of the idea of intersectionality. These are so muddied relationships that one thinks in terms of, you know, the Stuart Hall piece of structure, class of structure and dominance or something, so to speak. But I'm thinking that the idea that Lamont introduces here, the performance or performativity, also helps to rethink slavery, at least for most historians, to people writing about slavery, to rethink the ways in which freedom is something that is also performed.
Mm-hmm.
And necessarily, again, you know, gives us a much thicker texture, you know, a lens to think in terms of not freedom as an end, but freedom as a beginning of something else, which I think is contained in the work of Ira Berlin. But just another point that I just an observation, that Lamont, you started off by asking us whether we knew what year slavery ended in Brazil. And most people seem to know 1888. But I was wondering if you were introducing a new idea here about its end being related to some kind of autochthonous development that's related to the ways in which slaves become slaveholders, that kind of project that's underway there, that sort of prolongs the durability of slavery. It seems to me that has to be put up against the Tomich idea, and maybe you can speak to that more than I can, the idea of second slavery.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that there's something going on in the Atlantic space that is making the need, demand for newer commodities to enter, and therefore in that is a context, a constitutive context, in which we think about the durability of slavery. And therefore this that you present gives us another wrinkle on the sort of narratives that are also underpinning that sort of Atlantic general project.
One of the things that I found really interesting in there's been a lot sort of written on why the reason why I started off by asking people when if they knew when the when slavery was abolished in Brazil was precisely because I was trying to sort of get to sort of this moment where I encountered these texts where you see many white abolitionists writing about. Speculating about why and trying to find reasons as to why slavery has endured for so long. And in many cases, finding, or I would even say scapegoating, black, a portion of the black elite. And actually, Joaquim Nabuco, who I mentioned in the paper, actually says that some of the most forceful actors in the pro-slavery movement are free and recently liberated slaves. And so one of the things that I was just really sort of struck by that is sort of like how a number of these sort of elite white slaveholders then turned abolitionists kind of saw black people as sort of to blame for kind of the perdurability of Brazilian slavery. And one of the things that's kind of interesting is that on the one hand, sort of black participation in slavery is sort of used this sort of kind of to depict Brazil as sort of this kind of exceptional place where black people can kind of participate in this, that slavery sort of this kind of multiracial thing, this kind of unique thing that's kind of happening in Brazil. But then on the other hand, when Brazil is sort of standing alone as the last country to abolish slavery, and they're getting criticism from France and England and even the United States, that one of their scapegoats is this very small, relatively small portion of Brazil's population that has an investment in white, sustaining white supremacy. Because I think precisely one of the things I was thinking about is that, again, slavery in Brazil and how people think about slavery, particularly among free black people, is very sort of individualistic. And so you have in many cases sort of free black people really sort of thinking about how they want to identify sort of upon being free, how do they want to identify to slavery, what do they think about it, and then that really sort of motivates their actions, whether they choose to fight against slavery, whether they choose to be a part of it, or whether they choose to sort of be complacent. And so there's this element that I found very, very interesting in reading about this stuff, about sort of individualistic perceptions of what's going on, individualistic perceptions of slavery and the institution, and how they are a part of it, and really sort of individual desire in motivating kind of people's actions and feelings toward the abolitionist movement, and also toward racial identification. Do they want to identify as black? Do they want to, and what does that mean? Do they want to identify as white? How do they, and how does that, and I think that's something that crosses sort of gender lines as well. And so,
ethnicity, you said, matters in your presentation. I was wondering if you had detected any vast difference in the practice of ethnicity as people traverse the sea as opposed to traversing the land?
That's a really good question.
I could not say specifically. Where I would look for it are practices on the ships that are moments where Africans have space to move on their own. So there tended to be strategy on slave ships for captains and crew to let slaves loose, particularly men and particularly women and children. Women and children sort of tended to not be bound on ships for a host of reasons that were about them not being threats, which tended to be false because they were often at the center of a lot of the slave ship revolts that happened going across the Atlantic. But also, you know, for access for the captains and crew. So there are moments where in descriptions on slave ships of the passages that you get a sense of folks who are dancing or the kinds of songs people sing. So that would be a space. People have tried, if I'm not mistaken, to tie attempts to suicide as also practices that may be tied to particular ethnicities in particular regions. So the extent to which suicide is not death, but is like a renewal, is life, is return to the continent. Those potentially could be spaces where you get windows into how ethnicity plays a role. The other side, and this goes to class and thinking about class and status and work and roles, even in the context of the slave ship, is who on the crew are actually either mulattoes or Africans who are working as crew on slave ships. And that tended to be either some kind of relationship. So in a Senegal context, it will be folks who are already known as like Afro-European, which is a term that we're putting on them, but have some tradition of being in this kind of cross-section of engaging with Europeans, Africans, Wolof, Mina in the context of the comptoirs, and who have been working on the ships for some time, who have been working as grumettes or laptops, who have some kind of maritime relationship and labor role. And those tended to be tied, like even as I'm describing it, to be tied to particular ethnicities, not concretely. And these are also developments that come out of this moment. So even in that, ethnicity is this interesting thing that's also at work, and it's, it has its own history. But those tended to be tied to particular groupings. So those would be spaces where I would also look for it and try and pinpoint it further. People have tried to tie ethnicity, and Dr. Brown was talking about this yesterday, on the ships to where ships are coming from, and that's also a possibility. There's all kinds of arguments back and forth around how useful that is, but that also may provide us another kind of window to at least, okay, where does the conversation start? As to who is at the comptoirs, who is coming, who's in the captivities, who's coming on the ship, and who goes across the Atlantic. There's an interesting story, this is the last one, there's an interesting story from one of the ships where it's like 1696, and I think James Sweet also tells this story in his book on Alvarez, where one of the ships that is trying to leave San Luis, it won't leave. The travel, the weather does not allow it to leave. And one by one, the crew starts dying. So the negresas, the women on the ship, say, well, it's this woman over here, she's a sorceress. And so the captain, you know, tries to punish her, tries to talk to her, tries to whip her, all these different things. And she says, I am not going to tell you, but you can let me and my people off of this ship. And so what happens at the end, he gets threatened with sickness. He begins to feel himself ill, and he does let her and about four or five other women off of the ship. This is at San Luis Gore. And after that, the weather clears, and the ship proceeds on its way. So the interesting thing there in that story, besides the kind of sorcery element, which I think is always very important to think about systems of belief, is the way that she chooses particular people to go with her. She doesn't say liberate the ship. She says my people. And so there's something there in the context of both ethnicity, but also kinship relations, where you have people that you claim, even within particular racial or ethnic groupings, that are the ones that are your kin, and those are the ones that you take with you, for lack of a better term. So those are just ways to think about it. Thank you for that question. It's really important.
I wonder if you all have thought about how the issue of self-making and thinking about self-making gives us different research practices, maybe brings into sharper relief our own epistemological assumptions about engaging materials that are well-worn, right? That's the things that we know about, we've had to learn about to even come to the point of doing further study on the question of slavery. Yeah, so that's what I'm thinking about. Thanks so much.
Produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.